Welcome to another episode of Qt Widgets and More. In this episode, I'm going to show you how a view can communicate with the bottommost model. So in this whole setup, we have a bunch of proxy models in between the topmost view and the bottommost model. But the view need to ask the bottommost model a very intimate question. Stay tuned to learn how. Let's start out by looking at the user interface side of things. What you're looking at here is one of the dashlets from KDAB viewer, the tool I've told you about that I've implemented myself to be able to help running KDAB. And in here, I am now at the dashlet that shows me the trainings. And I've filtered in, as you can see at the top, to those training that a certain Jesper Pedersen has done in 2020. Let me show you the magic that I want to talk about here. If I right-click on my name here, you can see a context menu comes up, and I admit, that's not magic. The magic part comes that you can see the very topmost entry here is Jesper Pedersen. And if I click or if I just move my cursor on top of Jesper Pedersen, you can see a context menu with a bunch of different things that I can do with Jesper Pedersen. I can see his about details. I can just copy and paste to the clipboard his name. The way that this works is that the view, which is a QTable view at the very top, it's actually a QTable view subclass, but we'll see that in a second, went and asked the training model at the very bottom of a very deep stack of proxy models. It asked it at this cell that the user just right-clicked here. Does it have an employee? And the model at the very bottom said, yes, it does have an employee. If you go and review your model view APIs, there is no way of asking, is there an employee at this cell? For obvious reasons. But nevertheless, I managed from the top of the view stack, go through a number of proxy models down to the bottom to ask that question. To really appreciate the complexity of things involved here, let's go and look at the source code for this. At the very top, we'll find a class called KDV for KDAB viewer table view. As you can see from the code here, KDAB viewer table view is a subclass of QTableView. If I go to one of the vital method in all of this, we have a set model method on our table view. So when I use this table view from outside, I have some kind of model that I want to show, and I call set model on that. And as you can see, my set model, if we have a filter controller involved in this, then it calls the model that I give in. So I have my own model that I think I'm setting on the QTableView, but actually that model is set onto a filter controller as a model. And then on the view itself, we have the filter controller filter model. So let's just click here so we can see what the filter model is. M filter model, that's a filter model. Let's draw this up. So at the top, we have a KDV table view. The KDV table view has a model associated to it that it calls into, and that is an instance of our filter model that we've seen so far. We are back at the source now, and we're looking at trainings view, as you can see up here. The trainings view has this method here, UI pointer table, which is a KDV table. That's the class we just looked at. Set model text filter. So I specify the set model, and if we just go back to the table view here, you can see that that's the model that I get in here. And that's what will be the model that the filter controller is talking to. The text filter itself, however, is calling set source model to a cancel filter. So the text filter is listening to a Q abstract proxy model subclass that's called the cancel filter. And if I follow that one, we can see that the cancel filter is an instance of the class cancel filter. And it has a source model itself, namely date filter. Date filter is what we have up here. And it has itself a source model that is the training model that is at the bottom of the stack. Let's have a look at the inheritance, not the inheritance, but the call diagram for each of these models once again. So as we saw, the table view at the top has a source model. Well, it has a model. That model is the filter model. It has a source model. It's a QAbstract proxy model subclass that is called filter model. The filter model has a source model of its own, which is a sort proxy. It has a source model of its own, namely the canceled filter. The canceled filter has a sort model, namely the date filter. And finally, the date filter has a source model, which is the model that provides the real data, namely the trainings model. Let's walk from the bottom up through the stack to understand what each of those models provide themselves. So at the bottom, we have the trainings model. That's a model that provides a table, one row for each training we had, each column unique information about that training. However, we might not always want to see all of the trainings in one view. So we have a date filter on top of that that filters out all those trainings that are not inside that date range. We might not want to see the canceled trainings because that happens too. So we have a proxy model that filters out all of those trainings that have been canceled, namely those trainings that has a special flag inside the actual item. Next, we might want to sort them by length or sort them by instructor or whatever. So we have a sort proxy there. The sort proxy is a special class that I've implemented that knows about especially one thing that I'm very much interested in, money. So we have euros, we have dollars, we have Swedish kronas, and so on. So the sort proxy knows how to sort according to currencies. On top of that, as you saw, I filtered for Jesper. So there we have the filter model that does that. And it's truly beautiful. That is the model view when it's best, that you can take each pieces of this functionality and put it into a class that is super small and super trivial on its own. Okay, Jesper, come on. That is truly impressive, but what does that have to do with anything? Well, remember again, I right-clicked here on Jesper Pedersen and it showed me the possibility of all of these other actions that I could take. That information that it's actually truly in this particular cell, Jesper Pedersen, or an employee in KDAB, is something that the trainings model at the very bottom of the stack knows about. But all the intermediate models do not. So how do I go from the top to the bottom? So meaning from the view, how does it talk to the actual trainings model? See, all of this came around when I did this action. Let me just show you. I move the cursor, I right-click on that particular cell. When I right-click on that cell, a method in Qtable view is, of course, being executed, and it has the possibility to get a model index. But that model index is the model that the view sees, which is the filter model at the very top of the stack. I cannot take that model index and go to my model at the very lowest, namely the trainings model, because if I do so, it's a complete broken one. Some of the models filter away rows. Some might even filter away columns. Who knows? So that's a no-go. So let's go and look at the actual code being executed whenever I right-click on a cell. This is the code. It's in KDAB table view, the context menu event. It is given an event, as these event handlers usually are, and I'm creating the menu to show up. But the first thing I need to do is go to the event, ask for where on the widget where the mouse button clicked. And then I ask the QTableView, my superclass, what index is at that position. And remember again, that's the index of my filter model. I go and ask my employee menu. That's the class that shows all these possibilities in for the employee. I ask the employee menu, do you have an employee at this index? So that's the truly interesting part to look at. I go over here, an employee, who is the employee at the index? Okay, follow that. Down here we are. Now see, this is what you've all been waiting for. Index.data. So I ask the index about the data, which basically just means get the model that the index is associated to, call the data method on that model with this index and this particular integer here. This is a enum class. That's why I have this small plus sign there. I'll dedicate a whole episode on that one, that small plus sign. But imagine that it wasn't an enum class, then it would just be an integer that we have here. So I ask the model at the top, what data do you have for this particular row? So the view calls the data method on the model that it sees, namely the filter model. The filter model itself is a subclass of QSortFilterProxyModel. The QSortFilterProxyModel has an implementation of the data method. Let's have a look at that to understand what it does when it's given a role that it doesn't know about. Because the role that I gave it was a global roles :: employee ID. That is not one of those 20 different predefined roles. You know them, the display role, the edit role, the decoration role, whatever they were called. No, it was my very own integer. So let's see the implementation for QSortFilterProxyModel :: data. This is the source code inside of Qt for QSortFilterProxyModel :: data. We are asking for a given index with a given role. The first thing that it does is that it takes that index and it maps it to source. That is the QSortFilterProxyModel's own source model, the one that it looks into. It'll map it to that one. And it checks some things here, and then it calls on its own model, that is the source model that the QSortFilterProxyModel is looking into. It asks it for the data with this new index and with the role given on. Observe how the role just, it doesn't check anything with the role, it just calls it on. So the table view asks the filter model about the data for the employee ID role at that particular index that the user right-clicked on. The filter model just asks its source model after it has converted the index to one from the source model's domain, which calls onto its source model and so on until we make it all the way down into the training model at the very bottom. So here I am in the training model :: data method. The training model is the class at the very bottom of my complex proxy model hierarchy. The training model data method gets in an integer role here. I'm switching on that role, and depending on what it is, if it's an employee ID, then I simply return data.trainer. Data is a C++ class that represents a single training, you can see it up here, training data. It has a number of different characteristics, and one of them is just a trainer. To summarize, KDV table view at the very top of the hierarchy is a QTableView subclass. It implements the context menu method. When I right-click on a cell in my table, that method gets executed. I ask for an index from the model that is at the top of that hierarchy, namely the model that the view sees. I get an index for that. On that index, I ask for the employee ID, the topmost proxy model, the one connected to the view, doesn't know anything about that. So it just asks on and on and on until I'm at the very bottom where I can answer exactly that question. And on the way down there, I have filtered out rows. I might have filtered out columns. I might have reordered things. And every time the index changes. So imagine this very naive implementation that you might have had if you hadn't watched this episode here. You went to the model index that came out of right-clicking on that cell, and you asked it for which row are you on? And then you took that row and you gave that to the trainings model at the bottom, and you asked for what is the employee ID for this row? But given all the filtering that goes on, that wouldn't be the right one you asked for. Let's once again return to the user interface here. I've started KDAB viewer in my debugger this time. I have a breakpoint at the method in training model :: data, at the place where it answers the question of, is there a trainer on this particular line or for this particular model index? So let's right click and I hit the breakpoint right away. Now let's try and go up in the call stack here and find where it all started. It all started with KDB table view :: context menu event. So that's what gets called when I right click. It takes the index or it finds the index at the given position and it calls the employee menu has employee. That method is what we look at here. It just calls onto the employee. The employee goes and asks the index for the data. The index, the QModel index :: data is what you see here. It simply does this. If I have a model, then call data with myself and then this row. This is inside the source code of Qt. It calls onto QSort filter proxy model :: data. That is my filter model at the top of my stack. The interesting thing to observe here is over on this side where you can see R, I have my index here, I unpacked. And R, that is the row that I'm at, it's row 1. So we are zero based, so that is the second row from the top. That is the one that we're looking at. Now, if I go up, you can see that I go through a number of QSort filter proxy models, namely the sort proxy, the cancel filter, the date filter, and so on. And now you can see that my row actually changed to 21. And one more. And now my row is still 21. And now I'm at the top. Well, the bottom, depending on how you see it. That's where I ask about this particular training that was shown in the user interface. Now we are at row number 688. That's the amount of trainings that we've had since I started entering data about trainings into KDAB viewer. And this particular row has all the data about this employee. That's it for this episode of Qt Widgets and More. If you have trouble with your proxy models or any of your other Qt development, do reach out to us. We might be able to help you. Next time, I will show you how you can see that proxy model stack from within Gamma Ray. Pretty nifty stuff. So better stay tuned. I'm Jesper Pedersen. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Give me a thumb up if you enjoyed this episode, and I might be putting out more episode on Model View if you do.